This moment during practice for last year's Molson IndyCar race in Quebec has had dramatic impact on the sport that's still being felt. Rick Mears, executing a most rare mistake, punches through the inside steel guardrail. Debris collects Corrado Fabi, but Rick receives debilitating leg and feet injuries. Suggested by some he might never drive again, Rick has nonetheless returned. It's an abbreviated schedule, long ovals only, but enough to score another 500-mile win in this year's Pocono 500. It's created an unexpected opportunity for his teammate, Al Unser Sr., to go for the title.
I don't want to take anything else away from Al. I took Milwaukee away from him, and I feel bad about that now because that's just more points he'd have, and that hurt him, and I don't feel so good about that, so I don't want to take anything else from him.
The championship picture remains the same. Three drivers from different worlds within 3 points of each other. But three others still have a chance, and one, Al Unser Jr., is now just 8 out of the lead. ESPN, just this month, entering its 7th season as your number one auto racing network, presents Auto Racing 85. Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs, et bienvenue à Montréal. Greetings from St. Pete, Quebec. We're about 35 miles east of the city of Montreal. It's a rural region. They are big in farming around here, flowers, and French. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Larry Newman. Of course, this is Derek Daly, himself an active IndyCar driver. And you know, Derek, when this season began, it was almost a foregone conclusion that Mario Andretti would be champion, but that's not the way it's worked out.
Indeed, we've seen the first four, but Bobby Rahal and Danny Sullivan are two other drivers who still have a mathematical chance to take this championship. And in Bobby Rahal's case, the True Sports team really do seem to be ready to mount a very strong attack to try and take this championship, an attack that really started at Mid-Ohio.
Well, our colleague down in the pits, as usual, will be Jack Garrood. And here's Jack with more on this exciting points race.
You talk about parity on the kart championship circuit in 1985. Well, it's here in the qualifying order as well. On the pole, well, no surprise, that's Bobby Rahal. But on the outside pole is former Rookie of the Year, Roberto Guerrero. Guerrero, first time that he started on the pole in 1985. We'll watch for more from him on the start of the race.
Thank you very much, Jack. Well, the Molson Indy 300 is being brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? By the STP Corporation. On the world's racetracks, on the world's roads, depend on STP, your car care company. And by Pennzoil Motor Oil, quality protection, ask for it. We'll be back with the start and the starting lineup of today's Molson Indy 300 from Saint-Pete, Quebec, after these few words. Outside of row number one is Roberto Guerrero from Medellin, Colombia. Row number two, Ari Leyendijk, originally from Haas Holland, and Al Unser from Albuquerque, New Mexico. In row number five, originally from Milan, Italy, is Bruno Giacomelli. On the outside, originally out of California, now living in Indiana, Pancho Carter. In row number four, in seventh position, is Danny Sullivan, this year's winner of the Indianapolis 500 from Kentucky. And on the outside, the defending champion, Mario Andretti from Nazareth, Pennsylvania. In the fifth row, Jim Crawford, somewhat of a surprise here. He's originally from England, now living in Missouri, and Ed Pym. Row number six, Michael Andretti and Johnny Rutherford. In the seventh row, the 13th and 14th starting position, Jacques Villeneuve, the countryman from here. Jeff Brabham on the outside. In row number eight, Al Unser Jr., somewhat of a disappointing qualifying run, and Jose Lee Garza. In the ninth row, from Buenos Aires, Argentina, Enrique Keke Mancilla. On the eighth, or rather on the outside, is Dennis Firestone from California. In row number 10, perhaps the most experienced row maybe in the history of automobile racing, Emerson Fittipaldi on the inside and the legend A.J. Foyt on the outside in 20th position. 11th row, Howdy Holmes in the Foresight, number 33, and Dick Simon in car number 22. The 12th row, Gary Bettenhausen driving this week for A.J. Watson and Tom Sneva, who canceled out on his original Eagle ride and entered this Lola as a backup. He starts in scratch position. And in the 13th row, all alone, another promoter's option, Kevin Kogan.
A very, very exciting race here. The first 22 cars on the grid are all in the 1 second. So this little tri-oval is going to be a very, very busy place today.
Well, it's a very unusually shaped racetrack. This is only a triangle. It's called a tri-oval because we go around it, but the front stretch is 962 feet in length. That's just a little more than a tenth of a mile. It's only 60 feet wide. I say 60 because that is all the racetrack you have, and the groove is much more narrow. The banking is between 4 and 6 degrees, and two of the corners here are actually reverse turns. You go down and make more than a right angle, actually all three of them. You can see 128, 98, and 134 degree turns. That means it's like going down the street and turn around at better than 150 miles an hour.
That's right. Although they say the banking is between 4 and 6 degrees, actually from the driver's point of view, they virtually can't see it, they can't feel it. They would term this racetrack as a flat racetrack.
Now the key here is the laps go by so very quickly. About 20 seconds a lap, as Derek mentioned. Remember, we'll go 225 laps. That's 300 kilometers. We'll use the English version of how to make measurements here for this race because we are in Canada and they speak French. By the way, that equates to 187 miles. Bobby Rahal. There have been 10 track records set in 1984. Rahal has done it three times. Bringing the field around. We may get a green flag this time around. Nick Fornaro looks over the field. The green flag is out from Molson IndyCar. 300 is underway. Giacomelli, Bruno Giacomelli has looped between turns 1 and 2. He sits sideways and just barely is missed by Howdy Holmes. There is Bruno. What a close call for Bruno as Howdy was looking for room to go. And Bruno was sitting sideways right in the groove. The yellow flag is out. The yellow flag is coming out for the Giacomelli incident. A very lucky man for the man who started in fifth position in this race. Bruno Giacomelli getting down on the inside and maybe losing control over those speed up bumps we saw a little earlier today.
Very, very lucky man that he wasn't collected. There, in fact, is his teammate, Emerson Fittipaldi. So a bad start here for the Patrick team. Bruno can only be thankful that he actually got away with so many cars trying to get around him.
Well, apparently he was collected. There's Keke Mansilla also moving rather slowly. He looks like he has a flat tire, Derek, on the left rear. And Emo obviously made contact with somebody. You can see damage to the right front.
It looks as if they're trying to unhook Emerson's little air pipe that he has on these new Bell helmets to let him get out. But Emerson is now out of this race, out of the championship title for this particular event here.
Well, a lot of confusion there in the first lap because as I looked up, we were watching the monitor, watching the rest of the field go through number one. Emo a little slow getting out of the car, but I think he's okay. But I just happened to catch out of the corner of my eye Giacomelli spinning, and I saw him almost stop directly in front of Howdy Holmes. They took evasive action. Both of them avoided contact, but Emerson Fittipaldi obviously had trouble, as did Mansella. This is the same thing that happened to Emo last year. Didn't he crash early in this race?
That's right. And of course, the biggest problem for a man like Emerson to have to start so far back, if anything happens in the first couple of rows, as it did just here, Emerson is completely unsighted because he's trying to make up positions, he's trying to mind himself, and he's not concerned with everybody else at the front. And he arrives, cars are out of control, he's got nowhere to go, and the result. Go ahead, Jack.
Down here in the STP, Patrick Picks, and they're waiting for Bruno Giacomelli to bring his car onto pit road. They're going to be changing the rubber. They're getting set. We're awaiting his appearance here. Here he is now, and we'll watch for the crew to go to work. A tough break for a gentleman that started in the fifth position. The jack goes in. Not a lot of fuel having to go in, but having to change those tires in case they've been flat spotted. They're going to change all four tires, and they're doing it in kind of a unique way. Three air wrenches, changing the lugs, one man doing double duty, putting two tires on. They're just about completed under the luxury of a caution, but he'll have to start way in the back, gentlemen.
Well, Pat Patrick's STP march, which began this race way up in the third row. Emerson Fittipaldi started in 19th position back in the 10th row. So you can see that Emerson was kind of at the mercy of the rest of the field when Bruno spun there at the drop of the green flag. So the CART Molson Indy 300 race has been delayed here at the beginning stages because of a spin and a crash up in turn number one. 65 field of the Molson Indy 300 from Saint-Pie, Quebec. You see them swishing back and forth in the serpentine method to heat up the tires. The drivers are anticipating going back to green flag. This race has not completed one lap under green flag because there was a spin. At least three cars involved in turn number one in this very short racetrack for Indy cars after the green flag here in Canada.
We almost missed the fact that Roberto Guerrero made superb use of his first front row position to take the lead from Bobby Rahal. Guerrero now leading an Indy car race for the first time this year. We look to him to be very, very strong all through this race because in every practice session, Roberto was always there or thereabouts at the top of the timesheet. So Roberto Guerrero is very strong and has had a very good opening, although very short.
Well, we told you that this racetrack is most unusual in its configuration. A little earlier, Derek and I had a chance to tour the oval.
And at the first turn, this is exactly the racing line the drivers take. They get hard on the brakes here and turn in. You see the bump stops on the left-hand side. The drivers must stay away from those because it upsets the car too much. It upsets the suspension. Move out to the right-hand side along the wall leading up to turn two. This is only 800 feet long, this straightaway, leading into turn two, which is just here now.
If this was Pocono, it would be the tunnel turn, but no such bump here.
And much faster than Pocono, obviously. Again, out to the wall, exactly the racing line we see here, down to turn three, 175 miles an hour along here. On the brakes, turn into turn three. Again, the curbs on the inside just to keep the drivers on line. Accelerate hard through, back out on the front straightaway, and then start the lap again. Very, very fast, as you can see.
And a brand new cement wall for 1985.
And of course, that brand new cement wall that Larry talks about is the replacement for the guardrail, the Armco guardrail that caused so many problems for Rick Mears when he had that practice accident you saw at the start of our show.
We might also expound a little bit on Rick's comment in the open of our show that he took away Milwaukee from his teammate Al Unser Sr. What he was referring to was that he raced in Milwaukee. Al did not have a chance to drive. They really didn't anticipate him being that highly placed in the point standings to this point of the season. So Rick has got together with the rest of the team. Roger Penske decided to not race this event where, under normal circumstances, he might have been ready to go had Al not been so high up in the points.
Well, that was the first thing that Al had going for him when he came here this weekend. The second one just happened in the first lap. Emerson Fittipaldi is out. That's the second card that's been played in Al Unser Sr.'s favor this weekend so far.
Well, the third driver, of course, Mario Andretti, who is in essentially a three-way tie for the points lead. Al Unser Jr. is the one that's really fascinating. You know, had he won that race at Elkhart Lake when he crashed and injured his feet, Al Unser Jr. would be the new points leader. But everybody has had their misfortune so far in 1985, and what we have is a very exciting points race with two drivers, Danny Sullivan and Bobby Rahal, in it, but still only mathematically.
In the lineup behind the pace car at the moment, we have Mario in sixth place and we have Unser Jr. in 15th place.
Still trying to clean up the track after that incident here on the first aborted green flag, and we'll keep tabs on it for you and be back in plenty of time for the restart. From Colombia, who has never won an Indianapolis type car race, Roberto Guerrero reigns after 9 caution flag laps here in Saint-Pie, Quebec. Bobby Rahal, who won last week, set fast time this week, is second. Running in the third was Al Unser. Ari Leuendijk, the surprise of the weekend, fourth. Pancho Carter, fifth. And Mario Andretti, the defending champion and points leader, is in sixth position. This has got to be a little thrilling for Guerrero. He had that third at Indianapolis, a sixth at Milwaukee, but since then it's been a drought.
Indeed, Roberto has been most unfortunate this year because he's got a super team, a super sponsor, and he's well able to do the job, and it just hasn't come together. He's almost like Sullivan, was very good at the start, and Sullivan hasn't put it together from here on in. Roberto could be a very strong man from here to the end of the year. I think he's got all the ingredients.
Well, Phil Casey is the crew chief on this race car. Dan Cotter, of course, is the owner out of Chicago. Casey has a lot of experience in this type of racing, and particularly on the oval, so Casey may be one of the aces that Roberto holds in his hand here at this racetrack.
He could well be. Let's just see whether the action continues to be as frantic as it was in the first 10 laps, and let Roberto stretch his legs a little bit and get this car moving.
There's A.J. Foyt, who has entered the race here this week. You saw Tom Sneevels also involved. By the way, Foyt had a stop-and-go penalty coming for passing the pace car. No loss of laps, and a report from the pits that Dennis Firestone is having problems with the rear brakes. But we anticipate a green flag and a restart, the second restart of the 1985 Molson Indy 300. This will be the second time we've done this. This time, single file. Nick Fornaro once again looking the field over. Green flag is out, and the race is once again underway. There is Guerrero. Rahal really putting the pressure on Roberto as they go around turn number two. Just one more point. There are two cars that look exactly alike in this race. The number 76 of Jacques Villeneuve and the number 67 of Jim Crawford.
Roberto will have his hands full because Rahal has been the man on the pace here all weekend. He's been at the head of the timesheets every time they've run. Roberto had a lot of problems trying to qualify, did a super job, but I do think he's going to have his hands full here this afternoon with Rahal.
Well, Bobby Rahal looked like he was going to pressure Roberto there in the first green flag lap, actually our second start of this race, but Roberto has taken off and basically left Bobby in his dust. He has opened up about 20 car lengths over himself and the new record setter, Bobby Rahal. They are already beginning to lap A.J. Foyt. A.J., who obviously has had some mechanical problems. He showed up here somewhat of a surprise this week with a brand new Lola. Actually, it's not exactly new. It's very close to your heart, but A.J. is out there working with a race car that's not performing to his liking.
So here's Roberto, still leading, nice and comfortable. Little cushion between himself and Rahal. Roberto looks very, very good at the moment.
Running in third position is Al Unser Sr. Ari Leuendijk is in a challenging fifth. Pancho Carter is sixth. Running in seventh spot right now is Mario Andretti. Sullivan is eighth. Johnny Rutherford is ninth. And Ed Pym runs in tenth. But Roberto is really beginning to open up some distance. I am quite surprised that he's able to move so far ahead of Rahal.
This is a surprise. On a track as tight as this, it's unusual to see somebody run away like this. Roberto has it handled. He has a handle on everything at the moment. He looks strong. He looks good. I only hope it's going to stay together for him.
Now, if we go the distance under yellow flag, or rather under green flag, at least
okay,
until the first pit stop, you can expect them to go between 85 and 90 laps before they have to come in for a reload of fuel.
Down here in the pits with the first casualty of the weekend, and that would be Emerson Fittipaldi. Emerson, what happened?
I'm very disappointed. Just coming out of turn two, by some reason, AJ's car cut the engine, or he had a misfire on the engine, and his engine just died, and I hit AJ on the back. I brake very hard, tried to avoid, and still hitting. I spun off to the inside, and I hit badly the AMCO.
Not good in the heat of the points battle that you're involved with either, is it?
Yeah, that's a shame because the championship situation. My car was well prepared for the race. It was going to be a long race, and I was looking forward to finish well.
Well, it might be a long race for most, but it was a short afternoon for Emo. Back to the tower.
Thank you, Jack. Well, that answers a number of questions about A.J. Foyt, about Emerson, as well as Keke Mansella, and as we mentioned, almost Howdy Holmes. Howdy just escaped that.
We heard Emerson say that he hit the back of A.J. Foyt. In fact, A.J. Foyt has come in. They're looking around the car. They look around the right-hand front suspension, but we can't quite see whether A.J. can rejoin this race or whether he's out for the day.
Well, right now, Roberto Guerrero has everything to his own liking. Guerrero way out in front and seemingly pulling away. Rahal second, Unser is third, Pancho Carter is fourth, and Mario Andretti, the defending champion, remains in fifth. Roberto Guerrero, who said after Friday's practice session, it's so difficult to pass on this racetrack. I don't think I passed a single car during an afternoon practice session, has already begun to pass and lap slower traffic.
And he seems to make very light work of it. He is absolutely flying past the traffic at the moment. Roberto Guerrero leading this race.
That shot that you just saw from right on top of the pit wall, by the way, is right at the finish line. Remember, the front stretch is the longest straightaway on this racetrack, and it's only a tenth of a mile long. The two straightaways each cover about 800 feet, and altogether, this racetrack is only 8/10 of a mile in length. There is Guerrero getting ready to put a lap on, can you believe it, Tom Sneva. Remember, he got out of the Eagle because it, and Roberto getting sideways in trouble. Guerrero spins between turns one and two. Roberto Guerrero leading this race, punches the outside wall. The caution flag is out. Roberto Guerrero damaging the right rear wing. Obviously some damage also to the structure of that race car, and Roberto, I think, just eliminated him from himself from competition, Derek.
A very, very sad sight to see Roberto like that. He was so much in control. He ran very strongly. He was very confident. And now his day is over. There's just too much damage for anybody to hope that he can fix that car to get it back out again.
And Derek, as you watch this, he looks like he's out of control already. He hunkers it down to the inside, but it still never came back all the way.
He accelerates, just begins to get sideways a little bit, straightens it up. Now he's sideways. He almost held it. The unfortunate thing is he did a complete 360, 180, 360, almost to Danny Sullivan, almost caught it, and then it goes again and just hits the guardrail just here.
We have seen Roberto spin a couple of times on nationwide television, going completely around and catching it, but it just wasn't to be today, and that's a sad sight, and did not look like anything went wrong with the automobile. The car just got away.
He was pushing very hard. He was trying hard. He put everything he had into it. It just got away from him. It's a pity for Roberto because it looked as if he could have won this race.
Roberto Guerrero, who has finishes no better than 15th since back in Portland back in June, following on the heels of that third and sixth place that we told you about earlier, was the man to beat here at Sanair today. But something went wrong as he traversed between turns one and turn two, and Roberto Guerrero is now out of the race. This moves fast qualifier Bobby Rahal up top, followed by Al Unser Sr. and surprising R.A. Leyendyk. To all of our French-speaking audience up here in St. P, we told you we're very close to Montreal, and French is the language of the land. And if you're going to get along out here, Derek Daly and your brand new bride and I, we've gone out to dinner the last couple of nights, and I rapidly learned that if you couldn't speak French, or at least a second language, you were at a bit of a disadvantage when it came to ordering dinner. And Derek, you did quite fine.
My couple of years of schooling in the French language.
Well, we're looking at Bobby Rahal. Bobby Rahal, who won the most recent Indianapolis car race at Mid-Ohio last weekend. And in doing so, by the way, he was the fifth different winner in as many races. And this season, as it wears down to the final half, has turned out to be one of the most competitive of any in recent IndyCar seasons.
That's right. This whole IndyCar series is going from strength to strength, and it will continue to do so because it's so good. The cars are so good. There are so many sponsors involved, and there are so many good drivers now involved that you have so many different people on every start line that can possibly win the race. So the points battle shows just how competitive this season has been, and the number of race winners just shows you how good this series has grown.
Well, here are the winners for this year. Mario Andretti won three of the first four races, losing out only to Sullivan, but that was a big loss, the Indianapolis 500. Al Unser Jr. won two in a row, and then single victories have since been recorded by Jacques Villeneuve, Rick Mears, Bobby Rahal, and Emerson Fittipaldi. So those are the guys who have won at least one time in 1985, and there are so many others who appear to be right on the verge of winning, and you had to number Roberto Guerrero in that list until that unfortunate situation there between turns one and two.
That's right, very unfortunate. I know his charming wife Katie is in California at the moment. Katie is about to produce baby Guerrero in a couple of weeks' time, so this would have been a super birth present?
Yes, it would have been nice, but it obviously just was not to be. Roberto Guerrero from Medellin, Colombia, the True Value Master Mechanic Emerson Electric March is out of the 1985 Molson Indy race. Now, here are the number of different winners in total we've had in the recent seasons in kart racing. You can see the 1983 season jumps out at you. That was a year that Teo Fabi dominated, but we had eight different winners in all. And so far this year, the list is seven, more than 84 and more than any of the four previous years that are listed on this chart between 1979 and 82. And Derek, I kind of think we may have one more or two more before the season is over.
I think so, because the man who's now in second position, Al Unser Sr., he doesn't have his name on the winner's card this year yet. So I think 1985 is at least going to jump by another one, because Al Unser Sr. has been threatening all year to stand on the number one winner's rostrum, and I think it will happen.
And I also believe that Michael Andretti may also be close to being on the edge. He was so fast at Pocono. They've had a lot of little problems that have kept him from doing well in the 1985 season, but he's got a shot at it. Well, Jack Arruda is down with the man who led the first 20 green flag laps of this race, Roberto Guerrero. Jack?
And Larry, disappointment would be an understatement. Roberto, a fine run as long as it went, but what put you out?
Well, I just I was having quite a bit of a understeer with the car, and I was trying to compensate with the roll bars on the car, and I think I went a little bit too far, and unfortunately just got away from me going out of turn one.
Now, looking at you here, your left shoe is unbuckled there. Have you suffered somewhat of a little injury down there in the ankle area?
No, not at all. I was just getting changed.
Well, thanks for coming back with us in a tough break, because it was a great run to begin with for that Emerson Electric True Value team.
I'd just like to say hi to Katie at home, and I'm okay. I'm sorry I blew it.
That's tough when a driver has to say something like that, isn't it, gentlemen?
Katie, we all send our very best, and the important thing is your man's okay. Derek, the subject of roll bar or anti-roll bar came up, and what the driver can do in the cockpit.
Roberto would basically have control of his front and rear suspension in the cockpit. He'll have two levers, one on the right, one on the left, and he can make the front or the rear suspension soft or harder. Now, this can affect how the car goes through the turns. Roberto said he had understeer coming through the corners. Now, understeer is cured by making the back of the car stiffer. So he would have moved his lever forward to make the back of the car stiffer to make the understeer go away. If he moved it too far, he could have gone over the top. And instead of understeer at the front, he had oversteer at the rear, which is exactly what we saw, and he made contact with the wall.
Another driver involved in that first green flag altercation with Emerson Fittipaldi was A.J. Foyt. We told you that A.J. was slowing because something was definitely wrong with the race car, and unfortunately he made this long trip to Canada, Jack, and it has ended early.
Indeed, it has ended early for A.J. Foyt. A.J., there isn't a heck of a lot you can do when somebody drops a hand grenade right in front of you, is there?
Well, not really. You know, we backed off and it's fine. The kid in the 71, he has no experience on oval. Flat run down, run over the top of it, and bent the toe end all up and broke the wheel. And we tried to adjust it, but you can't. These type of cars, you just can't do nothing with.
We watched you when you came into the pits with the Copenhagen Gilmore car, and you wanted to get back out there. You tried to work the crew, and it was toot for knee for the day.
Well, it just bent the front end. Like I said, the first lap, the car was flying yesterday evening, as you know, and you know we knew it'd be tight, but I can't understand some of these yo-yos the way they drive now when the yellow's out running down over top of everybody.
I think A.J. Foyt can be the only man that can make those type of statements.
Well, he has driven a couple of these races. A.J. Foyt, the all-time mileage leader, the guy who has won more pole positions, the man who has won more Indianapolis car races, 67 to be exact, than anybody in history. So I guess you might say that qualifies him for his own opinion.
Indeed it does. The man, or the yo-yo that he spoke about, I wouldn't call him that. Mancilla, in fact, is running. He did come into the pits, did get a wheel changed. He is still running in the field. He's running 17th. And Giacomelli, the other driver who had trouble on the first lap, is still running. They made some changes to his car on that first pit stop. He is still running. He's in 19th position. So Mancilla 17th, Giacomelli 19th.
In case you're wondering why this yellow flag seems to drone on and on, it is a little longer than under normal circumstances for a situation like this. And the report is that when Roberto motored back around to the pits, he was leaking oil from the race car. And he did so all around turn number two, down the backstretch, to the entrance of the pits, and all up and down pit road. So they had a lot of work to do in terms of drying up the oil here left by the Roberto Guerrero incident.
Of course, on oval tracks, any suggestion of oil at all keeps the yellow flag up, because these walls are very unforgiving if a driver should lose it.
And remember, this is a very narrow racetrack. It looks like we may be ready to go back to green after this pass by. Bobby Rahal bringing the field around. The pace car is off the track. Starter looks the field over, and once again we're green with 39 laps complete. 39 laps of the 225 scheduled laps. Huddy Holmes, K.K. Mancella, Dennis Firestone, Tom Stiva, Bruno Giacomelli, and Kevin Cogan flash by as the leader, Bobby Rahal, is already out of turn number two. Down the back straightaway, 800 feet, alongside of the brand new cement wall, off of turn number four, down the front stretch, just a tenth of a mile, Rahal.
Second place, Unser Senior, is being pounded by Ari Leindijk in the 61 Lola, the Provimi Canada Lola. We have a spinner, we have another yellow, the Canadian Tire car.
It is either Jim Crawford or Jacques Villeneuve, and it looks like, it's hard to say, I think Jim Crawford was the man in the Canadian Tire car. That is Howdy Holmes, who had blue on the wing. It looked like Jim Crawford, and that is Howdy Holmes. I heard the collision. It sounded like somebody's tire went. Don't know what happened before the crash or after, Derek.
This is all action. It's so incredibly difficult to try and keep up with everything that happens on this spectacular short oval here. This is why there's a bigger crowd here than came last year. Unfortunately, one of their Canadian tire cars is now out.
We still have not seen, and now it's stopped. I can see the Canadian tire car stopped between turns one and turns two. And again, we cannot give you a confirmation on which one it is. We are guessing that it is Jim Crawford. There again is Howdy Holmes. The field is now motoring slowly down the front stretch. We'll take a gander at everybody as they pass by. Crawford is in the 67 car. Now we're getting confirmation. Yes, it is his. I see Jacques Villeneuve in the characteristic blue and yellow helmet motoring down the front stretch under reduced speed. And there's a tight shot of the Jim Crawford car. Big disappointment, Derek, because Jim Crawford, he was strong this week. He ran in the top 10 from practice, Friday, Saturday through qualifying, and even onto the starting grid.
That's right. He didn't want this because Jim needed a good showing, because he does hope to drive this car or some other car before the end of the year, possibly for Canadian Tire again at Miami.
Well, this is the T car, the Canadian Tire people. Their frontline car with Jacques Villeneuve remains in the race. Bobby Rahal still has the lead, followed by Alan Tresenior and Ari Leyendyk. Congratulations, man, race driver from Ann Arbor, Michigan, Howdy Holmes, walking back to the pit area still with his headgear on. You know, we've set brand new race records at six tracks so far in 1985, most recently at Mid-Ohio when Bobby Rahal averaged over 107 miles an hour on the road course there, but it's probably not going to happen here. We have just been riddled with caution flags the first 44 laps of this race so far.
There is no doubt that without the yellows, this would for sure be another track record, because Bobby Rahal, in fact, I think the first 9 or 10 cars in the grid were under last year's track record. So without these yellows, for sure, we were going to have another track record.
At the top of the show, we told you that 10 track records have been set in 1985, including here by Bobby Rahal. By the way, the last four races have recorded brand new one-lap track records. Rahal and Andretti are tied with three each. Now, these are new track records, not just pole runs. And one-lap track records have also been turned in by Scott Brayton at Indianapolis, Danny Sullivan, and Rick Mears.
While this yellow flag is out and the pace car has the field under control, Michael Andretti just made a quick pit stop, but it doesn't look very good because he is in trouble. He left the pits again with a very sick sounding engine. He doesn't have the engine cover on. He is taking advantage again of the yellow flag. He's again coming back in, but Michael Andretti's engine doesn't sound very good. It doesn't look good for Michael for the rest of the afternoon.
Well, in case you missed the top of the show, as we watch Howdy Holmes' vehicle being removed to the pit area, not the way that Indianapolis crews, of course, like to see it go. Here are some of the other guys who qualified for the race today who have remained in this event. Kevin Cogan added as a promoter's option. There you see the Dan Gurney crew headed up by Wayne Leary going to work on Tom Sneva. He's already been lapped once in this race, and this has not been Tom Sneva's day. Bettenhausen is here, Dick Simon, Dennis Firestone remains out in the race. We've mentioned Mancilla, Jose Legarza in the middle of the pack. Allenter Jr. is back at about 12th position. Jeff Brabham, Jacques Villeneuve, and Johnny Rutherford among those also in the race. Well, at a racetrack like this, it gets very demanding in terms of the physical pounding and beating that you take as a race driver, Derek. And you had a chance to take a look at one of those a little earlier this week. We've seen head straps in NASCAR, but they also use them in kart.
With the high speeds that these Indy cars now attain on these oval tracks, one of the most difficult things for the driver is to actually hold his head up. The G-forces are so great when he rounds the corner that drivers now need support. And we've seen these type of supports in NASCAR races recently. But we're with Skoal Bandit driver Ed Pym, and he'd like to show you the type of neck support and head support that they now use in these Indy cars. First of all, he puts on this, what they call a horse collar. Basically, it's a very heavy, dense foam which supports his helmet. After that, we've got the neck strap. The neck strap just hooks on the side here, and now it's very, very difficult for Ed to move his head left and right. Hence, as he rounds the corner, his head is completely supported by these extra straps and braces. Ed, do you think you could finish a race like this without these type of supports?
Well, I feel on this, it's a 7/8 mile small oval, and you attain speeds near 150 miles an hour. The G-forces are probably over 2, so your head feels like it's probably about 15, 20, 30 pounds. And, you know, without these, I think your head would be falling out of the car.
Quite astounding to think that you can average average almost 150 miles an hour in less than a mile, and you got to turn to the left three times, and all three of them are more than right turns.
And three turns, when you add into that 5/8 of a mile, shows you that on the front straight, if they do 165 miles an hour, on the back straight and in the middle of corner two, turn two, they never go below 165 miles an hour in the middle of the corner.
Going around a 98 degree turn. Can you imagine going down the street and making a bat turn to the left, turning into the McDonald's or the bank at 160 miles an hour? Well, Bobby Rahal continues to lead this race. Rahal again with a brand new track record. Exactly, it was 146 miles per hour. The father of Michael Andretti, Mario Andretti, continues to do very well. He's running in the top 10, but son Michael, looks like his day may be over. Here's Jack.
Well, it's kind of hunt and peck at the moment for the pit crew on the Craco car, stereo car of Michael Andretti. First, they thought it might have been a stray spark plug wire. They checked into that. That was not the case. Then they thought it might be just the spark box. They changed that. That's not the problem. Now the process that they're undergoing, and a laborious one at that, changing all the spark plugs on their Cosworth engine. Hopefully that will cure or remedy the situation. Right now, it's a big question mark down here as to what indeed is causing the misfire on the engine.
Well, Michael Andretti remains in the pit stationary as the cars continue to motor around. There's the number 36 of Dennis Firestone, and we would like to send along happy birthday greetings to Jochen. Jochen's dad happens to work on this race car being driven by Dennis Firestone, and they haven't seen each other for over 3 weeks, and there was no way he could get home for your birthday, young man. But he wanted us to pass that greetings along to you, and we're happy to do so.
Dennis qualified very well here. He's running in 15th position at the moment. He did have some problems on the first day here, on the Friday. He did lose control of the car, hit the wall, did some damage to the right front suspension, but his crew did an excellent job, had the car back out in ship shape. He qualified well, I think as good as he's ever done this year, and he's now running in 15th place behind the pace car at the moment.
Well, Dennis drives a Lola, and this race marked almost a resurgence that we thought we saw at Indianapolis of the Lola. You know, we started 25 cars in this race, and eight of them were the Lola chassis.
That's right. The quickest of them was Ari Leyendyke, who was using the Provimi Canada Lola.
Eight Lolas, one Eagle, and all the rest of the field, as usual, with Eagle marches. And yes, if you are a fan from Wisconsin, or maybe if you're from Oss Holland. By the way, if you're getting the signal and you live in Holland, geez, let us know. You've got a tremendous antenna. Anyway, that is not because of attrition. Ari Leyendyke runs in third because he's been there all weekend long. And so far, even though we've had about 25 abbreviated green flag laps, Derek, he's having a good race. He's had a good weekend. He spun also earlier this week, I believe. Did he not, in practice?
He had a slight problem with the left front suspension when he tried to pass Michael Andretti in the first turn down here. Broke the top front wishbone. But basically, he hasn't had many problems. They've done an excellent job after rebuilding this car from a serious accident during practice at Mid-Ohio.
Well, it's a brand new tub. There you see the average speed is way down to 68 miles an hour after 50 laps. The race record speed is 111 miles an hour, almost 112, and it's very unlikely that we are going to be able to approach that. But that certainly is no indication that the cars have slowed down on 85. As we have seen many times, repeatedly, the cars are significantly faster this year than they were a year ago. You know, Mario Andretti came into today's race as the lap leader out of 1,366 so far. He had led 514. Bobby Rahal was ranked third with 177. He's getting a lot of freebies today, Derek.
Well, take them any way you can get them. But here he is ready to bring the field down once again for a green flag.
Well, let's just watch this one. We've talked the last three through, and it hasn't helped. Bobby Rahal once again reasserts himself, and Pancho Carter, who has not won in 1985, he does have one career Indianapolis car win, has moved around Leyendyke, and Carter now motors quickly in third.
Pancho, of course, very much an oval track expert, came here with high hopes, a very, very good driver in this type of circuit, and now moving up to challenge Alonso Sr.
And there is Michael Andretti pulling back into the pit area. He tried and he has failed. Bunch, the number 99 car of Michael Andretti, going this time behind the pit wall. Well, that's Rahal, who continues to set the pace here. Ari Leyendyke, as we have watched, the number five of Rahal, has moved in to challenge Pancho Carter unsuccessfully, and that is the second running Al Unser Sr., the Pennzoil Z7 Special, the man who is the surprise of points in 1985.
Mr. Consistency here, Al Unser Sr., a man who looks as if he's going to win a race before the end of the year.
56 laps officially have been completed. The total of this race will be 225, as we mentioned to you earlier. It's 1.34 kilometers around the 8/10 of a mile here at Saint-Air, the Saint-Air Super Speedway. There goes Al Unser by. There you see Carter on the outside, Leyendyke on the inside. They go after for third, and Ari Leyendyke moves under the oval track veteran, and Leyendyke reassumes the number three spot and pulls away from Pancho, going around the number two corner.
Several little private battles going on here. We just see Leyendyke and Carter, Sullivan and Andretti having their own little battle. Unser Jr. just passed Ed Pym, and now Villeneuve and Kogan are at it.
Mario Andretti runs in fifth. There is the interval between third, make that fourth and fifth, I believe. That's Pancho Carter on the left-hand side of your screen, the Gallus Valvoline Hawk, who runs in fourth. There is Ari Leyendyke running third and seemingly moving in on Al Unser Sr. Rahal completely uncaring about what's going on behind him. Bobby Rahal is already beginning to make plans for the remainder of this race. They are undoubtedly running a calculated race. They know exactly how fast they want to go, hopefully how long they want to go before the first fuel stop.
Bobby had a very, very controlled race at Mid-Ohio, and I think he's going to want to do the same thing here. Not push anything, not take any chances, and try and build up a nice little cushion and hope that nobody else can take advantage of yellow flags over him.
Fifth and sixth, Mario Andretti, Danny Sullivan. Sort of deja vu from the Indianapolis 500. A little less at stake, but nonetheless, this is a major race on the Indianapolis Car Trail, and every race awards the same amount of points. Right now, Andretti certainly with the advantage over the entire field in that category, but Sullivan still has hopes and aspirations in terms of a championship in 1985.
Still one of the two men with a mathematical chance to take this championship, Sullivan, if he can have a good finish here.
Here comes Johnny Rutherford moving underneath. He sort of snuck up on Danny, and Johnny Rutherford, who's had another good oval track weekend, looks like he's feeling racy today.
He's been very fast all weekend. Interesting, he passes Sullivan here. We almost forgot Sullivan is the defending champion, did in fact win the first Saint-Air race here last year.
Well, we saw Rutherford move into sixth position behind that man, Mario Andretti. There's Rutherford in the background. There's Sullivan, Jeff Brabham, Al Unser Jr., Ed Pym, Kevin Kogan has moved up from the back, and Jacques Villeneuve. Good race for Kevin Kogan. He's about an 11th position, Derek, and he started dead last in this race.
He started dead last, but really his grid position didn't represent what he could do. Every time he ran here, he was always in the top six or seven. So Kogan, we almost expected, would have a good race.
There is Kevin Kogan again, turning the pressure up on Ed Pym. Ed Pym, remember, in one of Dan Gurney's Eagle. Tom Sneva decided the Eagle wouldn't work this week. Sneva stuck with his. Now we're back up front watching Leyendyke, and Leyendyke is beginning to fill the mirrors of Al Unser.
Leyendyke looks very, very strong here. Within about six laps, he's made up 3 or 4 seconds on Al Unser Sr., which is a huge amount on a short track like this. So I would look to see Ari Leyendyke make a strong challenge for this second position.
We're about 25 laps from the first scheduled pit stops. Remember, the cars carry on board 40 gallons of methanol alcohol, and the formula is to try and get, or you have to get, at least 1.8 miles per gallon out of a load of fuel, and that equates to between 75 and 80 miles an hour. There is Rahal moving in on Bruno Giacomelli. Bruno never lost a lap, I don't believe, after that first lap altercation. He pitted, of course, a couple of times, but was able to stay on the lead lap until right now, and here comes the Rahal Express.
And you can see that Bobby has already been held up a little bit because Al Unser Sr. and Ari Leyendyke have in fact gained a little bit on Rahal in that last couple of laps.
You know, the drivers who have experience running sprint cars, you could see from that shot just above the number one corner, this is a tight little racetrack, exciting, big enough for Indy cars, but the drivers who have driven sprint cars in the past said this reminded them of being at sprint car racetracks. Gary Benhausen said, I had a lot of thoughts about the New Bremen Speedway in Ohio. Of course, Gary drove in and won many sprint car races, and many of them took place at that half. And Ray Hall, is he slowing? I think the caution flag has come out. Caution flag is out on the speedway. Al Unser Sr. is coming into pit, taking this opportunity. Ray Hall lets Giacomelli get by. No exact word at this moment as to why the caution flag is out. But Ray Hall leading the field around as a number of the front-running cars have come in for pit stops. Perhaps a little early, but everybody figures that easily you can get by with two stops here at Saint-Air. There is Al Unser Sr. taking his first stop. Appears to be very routine. They get a full load of fuel on Al Unser Sr. back out on the racetrack. Mario Andretti getting ready to go, spinning those rear tires. And Andretti peels away, and Mario getting very sideways coming out of the pits.
Ray Hall is just coming in now, followed by Leyendijk. The Horton safety unit is still out on the track. It looked as if something fell off one of the cars. It wasn't a spin, nothing like that.
Well, here's Ray Hall pitting, and Jack Garrood is down covering all this frantic activity in the pits. Jack?
This is a break for all of the front runners, as you were alluding to. This was about the time pretty soon that they'd want to come in and take fuel. Now, one of the things that we spy as Bobby Ray Hall takes off, and Derek Daly, maybe you can react to this, down back behind what should be the overflow from the radiators, back by the gearbox, a lot of precipitation, liquid just pouring out of there. Could it be that that car is beginning to overheat?
It could very well be. At this early stage, in the first pit stop, they may have just overfilled a couple of little things on the car, so maybe that's just a little bit of overflow. I think let's just leave it to the next stop. We'll get more information.
Still some confusion over this caution flag, but we did see Kevin Colgan sitting sideways in turn number one during this caution flag. Today, more live automobile racing action here on ESPN, really, truly your source for sports at 12:30 p.m. that Sunday afternoon, live from Detroit, from the Michigan International Speedway, the Detroit Kart Grand Prix, the Detroit News Kart Grand Prix. Of course, all of the Indianapolis car drivers will be there. It's always one of the most exciting days in racing of the season. There are three separate races that take place on that day, capped off, of course, by the IndyCar race at MIS. We also have a report that Keke Mancella was involved in a spin in turn number one, along with Dick Simon, who has qualified here at Saint-Air Super Speedway this weekend. We told you that Kevin Colgan was sitting sideways in the middle of turn number one, so a number of cars were involved in that minor altercation, and we're still checking to see that if Kevin has returned to the race or not. I believe he is back in. He's in the back of the pack. Dick Simon is back out again. And I saw KK Mancella. Yes, Mancella actually running about 12th or 13th in line on the racetrack right now. The Horton medical crew and safety people still doing their cleanup work in turn number one. There is looking off of turn number three, down the second of two back stretches into turn number two on this 8/10 mile racetrack. Pancho Carter, 75 laps completed. And Pancho Carter right now has got to be a little confident, Derek, because this is the kind of racetrack that he likes. He's having a good day, and right now things are looking pretty trick for him.
Exactly. He's at the head of the class at the moment behind this pace car. Also, Al Unser Sr. made a perfect move at the right time to come into the pits and get his fuel load as that yellow came out. And he's straight back out in second place, whereas Ray Hall got stuck behind the pace car, and he's now about 9th or 10th in line behind this pace car and behind Ari Leyendijk. So Al Unser Sr. and Pancho Carter were the two who got the advantage out of that yellow flag.
There is the man who now lives in Indiana, in suburban Indianapolis, Brownsburg to be exact. This is his 12th IndyCar season, originally from Huntington Beach, California. Pancho Carter, whose dad, Dwayne Carter Sr., was one of the top drivers in the Indianapolis cars back in the 1950s and 1960s. And he's a guy that I always felt, Dwayne Carter Sr., that it would have been very appropriate had he won an Indianapolis 500. He falls into a category with people like Rex Mays, Ted Horn, and Lloyd Ruby, people who really deserve to win out there. But that can be a very cruel and a very demanding racetrack. Almost stung you this summer, didn't it, Derek Daly? But you got it back.
Indeed.
77 laps have been officially completed, and about 30 of them run under caution flag. Sullivan, Rutherford, Allanser Jr. going by. There again is Carter, who right now is at the head of that class we were referring to just a couple of minutes ago. Still following around the PPG Corvette specially made pace car. It's a pace car, by the way, that has Venturi tunnels underneath. There are ground effects built into the pace car. It's one of the pace cars that perform before and during all IndyCar weekends on the CART PPG trail. Results from the Italian Grand Prix. Alain Prost has won. He has won again. Nelson Piquet finishing second. Ayrton Senna was third. Mark Schurer fourth. Stefan Johansson fifth. And Elio De Angelis finished sixth. Alain Prost once again building up more points toward the 1985 World Championship, or at least he hopes so. Are green once again, and Pancho Carter is the man that everybody will be chasing now. Already out of turn number two, down the second of two back stretches. Al Unser Sr. runs second, Danny Sullivan third, Johnny Rutherford fourth, and Al Unser Jr. in fifth position. Ari Leuendijk has made contact with the outside retaining wall in turn number four. Derek, I believe what happened, a left front tire, I think, came off first. Ari Leuendijk did not make hard contact with the wall. You can see him moving around, but I think the trouble began in the left front of that race car.
It looked as if he had slowed down as he put the brakes on. He did feel something. Usually if a wheel comes loose, the driver can instantly feel the little vibration come through the steering. He backed off. He moved slowly out of the groove. We could see he was in trouble. There was no way he could stop the car, and he went straight into the guardrail.
Well, Pancho Carter has taken this opportunity to stop, and Jack Arud is down in the pits.
It was a fairly routine stop for your leader on the Valvoline crew for Rick Gallus' organization. They changed the outside tires, filled the tank back up with fuel, and he went back on his way.
Well, Jack, something we were trying to determine just before Pancho made that stop, I did not see him come in. Now, he might have come in during all the confusion of the last caution flag, but I think that is one of the methods he got the lead, is he hadn't stopped when everybody else did. But again, we missed it up here. Leuendijk, meanwhile, in the Provimi Canada Lola, looked like he was headed for a great weekend, but just wasn't to be. Jack?
Larry, one of the things that we've got to remember is with this rash of yellow fever, it's going to change all the pit strategies around. We're running about 5, maybe 10 laps, then going to caution. Normally, you should make two stops during a 200 or 300 kilometer event such as this one. But these crew chiefs now are getting back to their calculator saying, we burn a lot less fuel when we're at low speed. Let's figure out just when we should bring them in. And with the history so far in this first half of this event, they can count on a caution at almost any time. So it's really not that important when you pit. I say right now it's not.
Absolutely right, Jack. And thanks for that update. And we can confirm that Pancho had not pitted during the first yellow flags. And as you so aptly pointed out, we've run so many laps under yellow that everybody was conserving fuel. So you didn't have to make the stops normally when you would have to. That is Ari Leuendijk. And obviously Ari is okay. We told you that he had the car slowed down significantly before he made contact with the outside wall.
By far his best race so far this year. Ari has really come on in leaps and bounds this year after winning in the Super V title last year. This car, unfortunate that he should bang it so hard in this race, because that's a brand new tub that they built up last Wednesday after his accident at Mid-Ohio.
Well, Ari Leuendijk's day is over. Al Unser Sr.'s perhaps has just begun. Or has Al Unser Jr.'s day just begun? Suburb of Montreal, and today's Molson IndyCar race is being brought to you by Goodyear, makers of the high-performance radio The Eagle, and by Kenwood Car Stereo, sound perfection. It doesn't get any closer than Kenwood. Well, this race has truly been plagued by yellow fever. 52 laps of the 85 so far conducted run under the caution flag. No injury so far, minor wall contact by Roberto Guerrero and by Ari Leuendijk. A couple of other drivers, Kevin Kogan, Keke Mansella, Dick Simon, have been involved in spins or altercations, but so far nothing serious. But the drivers all told us all week long that this track may look simple, just three corners, it's less than a mile, but it is a tough place.
It is indeed. At the head of the field now we have the two Penske cars. They can control the next segment of this race because Sullivan can hold people back or make things difficult, and there's no way that Sullivan will challenge Alonso Sr., because Sr. will definitely want to go for the championship. Sullivan, I don't think, will try and challenge him at the moment.
Well, Derek, you know, I asked him earlier this week, what would you do, Danny, if it came down between you and Al? And Danny said, right now, I still got a chance. I know it's only mathematical, but I still have a definite chance, and unless it was the last race, I probably would not yield. But let's see how he plays it.
Let's see the sparks fly. Here they go. He's going for it. Danny has it.
Nope. Nope.
Well, Danny Sullivan gave it a good old go, good old college try, and I don't think Al Unser is out of the woods yet. Danny Sullivan is going to test him right now.
Probably the hardest man to get by at the moment will be Alonso Sr., because he's so experienced, he knows exactly where he needs to be, and he's probably done this so many, many times.
We had a tremendous enclave of foreign drivers, road racers, who qualified well here this weekend at Saint-Air, but right now, up front, three of the four first drivers, you would have to say they are graduates of oval racing. Al Unser, Johnny Rutherford, and Al Unser Sr. running in fourth. There he goes. Jeff Brabham goes by. Mario Andretti, Keke Mancella. You see the rest of the field falling by. But out of the top four, only Sullivan has a solid road racing background.
Ray Hall at the moment is running ninth on the track. He's had a lot of problems getting by Mancella. It took him three laps. He's now made it, and he now moves up on Jose Lee Garza.
The drivers also told us how difficult it is to pass here at Saint-Air. Dennis Firestone said earlier this week, after he spun, that once you get out of the groove here, you're history. The track is three very lanes wide. It gives you a lot of room to maneuver out of trouble, but the fast lane around here is very narrow, and the oval trackers right now are showing the road racers that's where it's at.
The two Penske cars are just putting about half a second between themselves and Johnny Rutherford, who's running in third place. And Johnny's just a little bit ahead of Al Unser Jr., Jeff Brabham, Mario Andretti, Jose Lee Garza, and then Bobby Rahal.
Al Unser Jr. in the Domino's Pizza Hot One. That number 30, by the way, is not by chance. You've seen the ads, 30-minute delivery. Well, that's where the 30 comes from on Al Unser Jr.'s car. He's had a second and a fourth in the two most recent races. Earlier this year, he was second at Portland and won at the Meadowlands and at Cleveland. Back-to-back victories, and the man who has suddenly burst onto the scene, and he's in the thick of the points battle for 1985.
Jeff Brabham, running fifth at the moment, is pounding Al Unser Jr. at the moment, running ahead of Mario Andretti. But Jeff Brabham in the Gallus car, very unlucky this season so far, but a very, very strong racer at all times.
There is Sullivan still following around Al Unser Sr. Sullivan seemingly not able to get around. Both cars running about the same speed, or maybe Sullivan just a little quicker. Difficult to tell, but it's so very difficult to find a way around on this racetrack. Well, as we watch the yellow Pennzoil Z7, the number 5 of Al Unser Sr., of course, the man that we have been accustomed to seeing running this car is Rick Mears. He won a race on ESPN earlier this year at Pocono, and right now he's the gentleman.
Rick, it's got to be with a little bit of maybe disappointment that you're watching the Pennzoil Z7 lead this event.
Well, it is a little bit, but if it could be, you know, the only way I'd like it is to see the Pennzoil car out front, and Al's doing a good job, and hopefully, point-wise, he'll hang in there.
You know, we alluded to it in the beginning of our telecast that you said at Pocono, I don't want to deny the gentleman an opportunity to win the championship. I cost him some points at Milwaukee, and now I'm going to step aside in the key, crucial races for the points battle. Is that tough for you as a driver to make that sort of decision?
Well, it is, you know, it's tough, but I'm not really just stepping aside for that reason. We would have had to get three cars ready to go for this race within a week. And when we lost the car at Pocono, that put it ran us a little short as far as equipment goes. So, you know, it was a combination of things. I'm not really just willing to step out for much of anything. But, you know, with Al running the way he is, you know, I would do whatever it takes. And if it comes down to that, that's what I will do.
Not bad to have a backup driver like Al Unser Sr. to take over for Rick Mears, is it, guys?
Not bad at all. As a matter of fact, Rick Mears has entered only four races this year. He's got one win. And as everybody knows by now, Al Unser Sr. has run all but one race, and he's ranked second in the point standings and very much in it for the points championship. 98 laps have been completed. Sullivan is second, Rutherford is third, Al Unser Jr. fourth, Jeff Brabham is fifth, Mario Andretti sixth, Jose Legarza, 7th. Bobby Rahal, 8th. Keke Mansell, 9th. Ed Pym, 10th. Jacques Villeneuve, 11th. In 12th position is Pancho Carter. 13th is Kevin Cogan. 14th is Bruno Giacomelli. And they number among the top runners still here in action at the Molson Indy 300 at Sanair. And the first three positions, as we see Gary Bettenhausen duck into the pits in the Menards leader card, number 24, March to 1984, updated version to 1985 specs. They have worked very hard. A.J. Watson, there you see him on the right. Phil Kruger, also an active IndyCar driver, labored very hard with that car this weekend to try and get it into the field. As a matter of fact, they had an 11th hour motor change just before qualifying, and it was just enough. They got in.
Well, the two Penske cars stretched their legs a little bit. Now Rutherford's caught them again. Rutherford is now right on the tail of Danny Sullivan. Rutherford looks as if he may make this a three-car train at the front.
Well, Johnny Rutherford, a very interesting story. There you see him on the outside of your screen. Al Unser Jr. in the red, white, and blue Domino's car running in fourth. There you see the interval between first, second, and third. And right now, that man holds on to first. There you see second creeping into the picture. Sullivan chases around. Al Unser Jr., by the way, has slowed temporarily. Now he seems to be back up to speed, and Jeff Brabham has moved into fourth position. Jeff Brabham has taken over fourth as Al Unser Sr. continues to lead this race.
Unser Jr. made a little mistake exiting turn one. Looked as if he missed a gear, or he missed the groove a little bit turning into turn two. Brabham went by, Mario closed right up. He sorted himself out by turn three, and now he's back running strong again, but he did lose that vital position.
The people who are still running competitively and within about 1,000 yards of the leader, there is Jeff Brabham now in fourth position after 104 laps have been completed. Andretti running in sixth position, Garza in seventh, Rahal eighth, Pym ninth, and Jacques Villeneuve 10th. Those are the guys seemingly on the pace with the leader. The leader is pulling away, although not at a dramatic pace. Jeff Brabham, age 33, in his fifth season, living in former President Richard Nixon's hometown, San Clemente, originally from Australia, of course, Jeff. But those 10 cars, seemingly still in it, have a shot at victory here today.
Rahal, since he took on that load of fuel in the first pit stop, doesn't quite seem to have the pace he had earlier on. Now, they may have made a little chassis adjustment, as they can do in these pit stops, but Rahal is having a little bit of trouble making his way up to the front of the field. He now has just passed Garza, so he has taken one position, but he seems to be laboring just a little bit more than he was earlier on in the race.
Well, remember, we mentioned that no matter how quick you are here, and some of the drivers even told us that, it gets to the point where if the guy in front of you is running on the lead lap, if he does not want you to pass, chances are, unless he makes a mistake, you're not getting by. Al Unser Sr. leads this race as we approach the halfway point. 112 laps will mark halfway. This race is going by very, very quickly. On the world's racetracks, on the world's roads, depend on STP, your car care company. Well, the biggest story to hit racing in quite some time continues to be Bill Elliott. When he won last week's Southern 500, it was his 10th in 20 Grand National race wins in 1985. His winning total in terms of dollars now is $1,850,000 for the current season, more than double Mario Andretti's record take of 1 year ago. Well, a current Indianapolis car driver says that he may become the next Grand National driver, and he has purchased his equipment from none other than the Elliots, and his name is Chet Phillip. Alan Kowicki will definitely become the next Grand National driver. The ASA grad will run in five races here at the end of this season, only five, so that he can preserve his rookie status should he choose to go after that title in the 1986 season. Former world driving champion Emerson Fittipaldi says that America should brace itself for the onslaught of some very significant equipment in the next coming IndyCar season.
Ferrari for sure announced they will come, but they don't know yet when. It looks like the end of next season. Lotus has already built his car, their car, and is ready to come anytime now. And McLaren, I would say for 8-7.
Some news from Formula One. Italian Teo Fabi has re-signed with the Tolman Hart Group for next season. An American Eddie Cheever will move over to Ram. The 1985 Off-Road Racing Rookie of the Year has been designated, and it is none other than the son of a legendary movie actor, Clark Gable. The younger Gable says, "I'll make my living off of racing." Those of us who cover this sport for a living remain saddened this weekend at the loss of a couple of gentlemen on the way home from Darlington last week in a private plane crash. AMA's Dale Singleton, a two-time winner of the Daytona 200 motorcycle race, and Richie Panch. Richie is a former Grand National driver. He was an employee of Motorweek Illustrated and a former employee of ESPN. He was a colleague, a competitor, and a friend, and we'll miss him. This has been the STP Inside Track Report. Quebec, just east of Montreal. We're watching the Molson Indy 300, 300 kilometers, the mid-race recap, 113 laps completed. The average speed was way down at 81 miles an hour after qualifying at almost 150. There have been four different leaders, four lead changes, a total of five very long cautions. As you can see, over half the race, 58 laps completed underneath the caution flag, but we've been clean and green for a number of laps. Leaders, Roberto Guerrero, before spinning out between turns one and two all by himself, then Bobby Rahal took over. Ari Leuendijk briefly under pit stop conditions, then Pancho Carter, because of a late pit stop, led seven laps, and now Al Unser Sr. has asserted himself in the lead in this most recent green flag segment.
The Penske team.
Out of the race so far, Michael Andretti, Emerson Fittipaldi, Roberto Guerrero, A.J. Foyt, Ari Leuendijk, no injury by the way, Jim Crawford also involved in a minor crash, and then Howdy Holmes. Seven cars so far out of the race, the top 10 to this juncture, leading of course Al Unser Sr. In second spot is Danny Sullivan, third is Johnny Rutherford, fourth Jeff Brabham, and quickly climbing I might add, fifth is Al Unser Jr., sixth Mario Andretti, seventh Rahal, eighth Jose Legarza, ninth Ed Pym, and tenth Jacques Villeneuve, the Canadian, running the Canadian Tire car.
Okay, since we got those graphics, in fact, it's Jeff Brabham who's making all the right moves out here at the moment because he's gone by JR. The two Penske boys are in traffic, and Brabham has now moved right up behind Danny Sullivan. So Jeff Brabham looks to be the fastest man on the track at the moment.
Al Unser Sr. being held up behind Bruno Giacomelli. Remember again, it's tough to pass on this racetrack. Even when you're passing, what an advantage this is for Sullivan and particularly for Jeff Brabham. The crowd is rising to the occasion. They are really responding to Brabham's challenge.
I think it was Jacques Villeneuve because they gave him a standing ovation a couple of laps ago when he took 10th place from Ed Pym. He then took 9th place from Kiki Mansilla. He's now taken 8th place from Jose Legarza. So the hometown favorite, Jacques Villeneuve, here is giving the crowd plenty to shout about.
But Derek, let's watch this carefully. There are more than one lead car directly in front of Al Unser Sr. Sr., Sullivan, and Jeff Brabham are really going to have a dice about it now for the number one spot. Directly in front of them, I saw Kevin Cogan, Bruno Giacomelli, and Tom Sneave, I believe. Al Unser has disposed of one of the lap cars. Sullivan goes around. Jeff Brabham now going to the inside of Kevin Cogan. Johnny Rutherford approaching. There is Jacques Villeneuve, whom we were just talking about. He's moved up to eighth. Is that right, Derek?
He's now in eighth position and closing rapidly.
Jacques Villeneuve, the Canadian Tire White's Auto Center Labatt's number 76, is beginning to flex a little bit of strength here just past the midpoint of this race. Al Unser Sr. has been flexing strength all race long and still working on first Tom Sneva, then Bruno Giacomelli. Giacomelli goes to the inside and sets up lap cars two abreast right in front of the leading trio.
The difficult thing for Bruno is now he's completely taken with his dice with Tom Sneva at the moment, so I can't imagine where he's going to bother to watch in his mirrors too much for what's happening behind him.
We're going back and picking up on the progress of Jacques Villeneuve once again in the number 76 car. It's pronounced Villeneuve, by the way, but for our American audience, of course, we are all accustomed to Villeneuve. There he is, the young man who is the brother of the legendary Gilles Villeneuve, one of the Canadian national heroes, one of the immortal Canadian national heroes. For Jacques, running competitively on an oval is somewhat of a new experience. He told us earlier that he's still learning every time he goes to an oval, and he hopes to continue to improve his progress so that perhaps he can run in the three 500s next year, including Indianapolis, which he had to pass earlier this season.
He did stand down for those super speedways. But here we see Giacomelli running quite slowly. He did go offline earlier on, and Kogan now seems to have caught him very fast. So I think Giacomelli's in trouble.
Al Unser approaching Tom Sneva, and Al Unser told us earlier this year he feels that what Tom Sneva has done to him on two occasions in the past 12 months has been wrong, and there may be a tinge of animosity there. But this time, Sneva, with a little bit of a wiggle, moves over, and Al Unser Sr. gets by. And now the yellow flag is out once again, as Sneva is between first and second place. Bruno Giacomelli has spun, exiting turn number one. Watch for him above Al Unser. You see him there going through, and there is Bruno. Smoke coming from out of the engine. Well, I think it's coming off of the right rear tire, heating that thing up when he went sideways. He may have touched the wall, Derek. It looks to me like there's a little bit of damage on the wing there in the back.
I think the reason he slowed down earlier on was because the car got very loose. And you can see on the right-hand side of the rear wing, the right side plate, the plate that bolts the wing together, is in fact gone. If that fell off, he would have lost the downforce in the car, and hence that's probably why he spun. Down to you, Jack.
Unser Sr. brings his Pennzoil Z7 into pits, watching over carefully as Rick Mears. They're going to change. Looks to be three tires. Checking, taking on a full load of fuel. This was a good break for Sr. as he was about to overtake Tom Sneva. The jack is down. He's off and away. What about it, Rick? A pretty good stop, was it not?
Good stop. It was real good.
Well, that's the story from pit road here with the leaders. Let's go back to the tower.
Well, that's kind of a pleasant surprise. We get Rick Mears as another guest commentator here on ESPN. By the way, we are within 100 laps from the finish, so it's likely that that is the last planned Al Unser Sr. pit stop. We could see the last ones coming up here in just the next couple of laps. Takehart, Bob Jenkins and I are ready to fill you in every Thursday evening on all the latest from the motorsports scene. We'll bring you up to date on the best motorsports with the best reports and highlights and features from every circuit, both foreign and domestic. It's just one more reason why our auto racing coverage has won awards as the most comprehensive of its kind on television. We won our ACE Award in 1984. We really are the driving force on every front across the racing scene, at least we think so. ESPN, your driving force in auto racing coverage. Still running under yellow, but it looks like we may be going back under green flag this time around. Mario Andretti right now holds down the top spot, but our records indicate he did not pit under the last caution. Danny Sullivan has scooted underneath Al Unser Sr., and Danny Sullivan is running in second spot in the race right now, getting underneath his teammate, that man, Al Unser.
We just got the answer whether Sullivan would help or hinder Unser Sr. They are both racing. There's no team orders. They're both going to go for this championship.
Mario Andretti setting the pace. Joseli Garza is out in front of the pack. Joseli is almost a lap down to the leader. So we show Andretti having not pitted. We may have missed him, but Andretti having not pitted, leading with Danny Sullivan running second, Al Unser running third. Fourth is Al Unser Jr., and fifth is Jeff Brabham. Sixth is Bobby Rahal, who has yet to show that speed that we saw in the early half of the race.
During that last yellow and that last lot of pit stops, Brabham, in fact, lost a couple of places and Rahal gained some. We don't show Brabham or Rahal in the top five at the moment.
Joseli Garza brings the field around out of turn number four, the 5-degree bank corner once again, followed by Mario Andretti. And now we get an updated report that Andretti apparently has pitted, and he is almost the length of the racetrack behind the leader, Danny Sullivan. Mario Andretti is being shown as 25 seconds behind, or rather 22 seconds behind the leader. So that man in the red and white trim, Miller American, number four, right there, Danny Sullivan is the leader. Andretti has pitted but lost a significant amount of ground on the racetrack. It is Sullivan, Al Unser Jr., Bobby Rahal fourth, Johnny Rutherford fifth, 5 seconds back, Jacques Villeneuve in sixth, 5 seconds back. Pancho Carter is in seventh, and we have an update for you from the pit area and our colleague Jack Aru.
Larry, actually, it was an ill twist of fate that cost Mario Andretti that lap and almost two laps. Just before the caution was displayed, he was called in by kart officials via the black flag for what they thought was leaking something on the racetrack. He came in, the kart officials looked, gave him a clean bill of health, but by the time they sent him back out, he had gone one lap down, and when the caution came out, he went almost two laps down. So he's not on the lead serial, as you've alluded to, but it wasn't due to the pit stop under caution.
Mario Andretti, the man you're looking at right there, is about whom Jack was speaking, the Beatrice car. By the way, partners Mario in the upper right-hand corner. The report from Europe is that the Beatrice Lola, which debuted this weekend in Formula One racing, had a difficult time qualifying for the race, was well below 20th on the starting grid, and did not place among the top 10 in today's race. But Mario Andretti still hangs on, clutches ever so slightly to the top 10. There you see him moving underneath Jose Legarza, and there's the leader in the race right behind him, Danny Sullivan.
Villeneuve still continues to have the crowd on their feet here. He just went by Johnny Rutherford down into turn three. He's now handing Bobby Rahal. Villeneuve has the bit between his teeth. He wants to have his best result here to coincide with his Elkhart Lake win, of course.
Danny Sullivan, the man who has won 4 out of the 30 IndyCar races which he has entered, and of course topped off with that win in this year's Indianapolis 500. Sullivan has had a very solid Indianapolis car career. He has some experience in Formula One driving. He is one of the glamour boys, I guess you might call him, of IndyCar driving. But when it comes to driving race cars, Danny Sullivan is very serious, and there's nothing Hollywood or nothing propagated about Danny Sullivan behind the steering wheel. He is 100% racing driver when he's there.
Our man Jacques Villeneuve has done it again. He's passed Rahal. He now moves into fifth place. He's now in the top five, first time on the leaderboard today. He's now chasing down Jeff Brabham.
Now we get to the point in the race where you start thinking about the strategy toward the end. There are 75 laps remaining, 75 laps of under 25 seconds. So that gives you an idea of how rapidly things will elapse here at Saint-Air. Danny Sullivan has opened up between himself and his teammate, Al Unser Sr. Al Unser Jr. running in third spot. But as Derek has alluded to a number of times the last 10 laps, the man we're beginning to pay attention to is Jacques Villeneuve. And if Villeneuve could win here, what a spectacular day this would be. Mario has slowed. Mario Andretti slowing as he creeps along the inside of turn number 3, well below the white line. Mario Andretti coming into today's race with the points lead, looks like he may be in trouble. What a moment for Al Unser Sr.
If Sullivan wins this race and Al Unser Sr. is second, then there's a four-way battle for the points
Absolutely.
Title suddenly.
And Al Unser will have a significant points lead, particularly if Mario drops out, because Emo has already dropped out. And Al Unser Jr. may well find himself in second place behind his father in the point standings. Mario Andretti, crawling, agonizing, down pit row, comes to a stop along the cement wall. The crew goes to work on the rear of the race car. No frantic and Jack, it looks terminal.
It looks as if indeed, as you said, it's terminal. They're taking the bonnet off. Not a lot of frantic work here. The crew is all now coming over single file back over the wall. Mario just resolutely staring out at the rest of the competition, standing by, true competitor that he is, hoping that he'll get an opportunity to go back in. The engine has been killed, and we'll give you more as soon as we have it. Let's go back to you.
Well, thank you, Jack. Mario had a sixth and seventh place after coming off an injury that was suffered during the running of the Michigan 500. He missed the Elkhart Lake race. He had a second place wrapped up last week when a tire went go on the next to the last lap. He was still able to hold on for seventh in the standings, but boy, the year is really going away on Mario.
Things really turn fast in racing, as we can see by Mario Andretti, as we can also see by Danny Sullivan, the man, the Miller man here, back in control again, back in control of this race.
Danny Sullivan started out the 1985 season with three fourth place finishes, and Derek, here's the man you've been watching, Villeneuve, and he has got the whip turned up.
Since the last pit stop, Villeneuve has made more progress than anybody else on the track. He took several positions lap for lap from people and is now running in a very strong fourth place, chasing down Al Unser Jr.
Well, Villeneuve right now is ninth place, or rather 9 seconds behind in fourth place. Al Unser Jr. is just 4 seconds behind in third. We told you that Jacques Villeneuve is new to oval track racing. He's been working very hard to try and get better on this type of racing. He is not completely sure for his ride for 1986, but he has hopes. Jacques, obviously, this is not a road course, and I guess it's almost an oval, but Are you beginning to feel maybe a little more comfortable on oval racetracks, places where you turn left all the time?
Well, definitely with a small one, you know, like here at Saner, where it's 7/8 of a mile, and the Milwaukee 1 mile, and Phoenix 1 mile. They don't bother me too much, and I got no problem with them. I get used with it because you brake, you accelerate, you almost feel like you're on a really small road race. It's a super speedway. We've been having problem, and I think it's due to a lack of time on the racetrack, you know, and the lack of experience we've been having with the racetrack. So I hope in the future it's going to get correct. Otherwise, we're going to try to do our best in the road race.
Jacques Villeneuve, the driver of the Canadian Tire, White's Auto Stores, Labatt's Beer, number 76, the blue and orange, characteristic colors of the Canadian Tire Company. In his last three races, he's had a fourth, a first, and a third. And as we go back up front to check on the progress of the leader, Danny Sullivan is doing quite fine, thank you. Sad news from the pits. Mario Andretti apparently out of this race. The car has been pushed behind the pit wall.
So Unser Senior is now the only man in the top three who can actually improve his points tally. His two rivals, Mario and Emerson, are now out, finished.
And as we are watching the leader here, they're approaching slower traffic. Dennis Firestone will be the first car. There you see Firestone, Ed Pym. You can see the first three positions have really tightened up. There's Sullivan, there is Senior, and right behind Senior, right off the exhaust pipes, Al Unser Jr., the best trafficker, may get through this with the lead. Let's see what happens. Sullivan goes to the inside of Dennis Firestone, makes quick work of him. Now he looks toward Ed Pym. Danny Sullivan keeps her down on the inside between the cement, moves up a lane, and Pym has moved quite a ways away from Dennis Firestone, and Sullivan has a little bit of breathing room now before he reaches Pym.
Dennis didn't quite see the leaders in time there, did hold them up slightly, but they are still together. They are still at the head of the field. Sullivan has just pulled a little bit on Unser Senior that lap.
There is Jeff Brabham. Jeff, during the last pit stops, did lose a lap. Right now, he is shown in ninth position after such a strong performance in the early part of this race, when he looked like he was a bona fide candidate to win this one.
Here we see Ed Pym in the Eagle, the lone Eagle here, but still running very strongly. Now following his teammate, Tom Sneva. Tom, of course, opted to take the Lola T900 out for this race, but not having a happy day.
Ed Pym is the last guy on the lead lap. Pym is in eighth position right now, and you can see he is the length of the racetrack behind the leader, Danny Sullivan, and Sullivan is getting ready to put Pym one lap down. In 10th position is Tom Sneva. In 9th position is Jeff Brabham. Both of those guys are one lap down, and the leader of the guys more than one lap down is Jose Legarza, which is in 11th position. Danny Sullivan is the defending race winner here, so obviously he knows this racetrack very well. We asked him earlier, is that somewhat of an advantage?
Danny, do you think that because of your performance last year that maybe you got this place down a little better than most of the drivers? Do you think you have a leg up in that area?
I'm sure it helps first by just running the whole race and finishing the race and just figuring out a little bit of what we had to do, what the traffic was like. Big Al last year, he went out on the first lap or the first corner, you know, so he doesn't really have an idea what it's like in traffic and during the course of the race. And I think that might help us a little bit tomorrow.
Down here in the pits with Mario Andretti. Mario, it seemed, from what we gather, a very simple problem that knocked you out.
Well, I don't know what the problem was, except that the car has been overheating for the last 70 laps. And finally, the engine just started going sour, and I pulled in.
The report we received from your crew was that it was some sort of a faulty hose clamp. But you've had a chance to take a look at the competition out there. Any one driver that you think has the advantage over the others for the victory today?
Well, not really. I think it's whoever is up front at the time. I think it's going to be the luck of getting in and out of the pits quickly, because when you're behind someone, I don't care if you have a half a second on them or better, you're not going to get them. It's that kind of a track. So, as I said, it's whoever gets the pit work done properly.
A tough break. We'll see you next time up at Michigan. Back to the tower.
Well, while we have been watching, Al Unser Sr. has moved around Danny Sullivan as he slows. Danny Sullivan looks like he may be dropping out of this race. Back with more after this. Indianapolis 500, Danny Sullivan will not win again today. He has not victored since that race, the second one of the season, while we were listening to Jack Garut and Mario Andretti. And just as we went to the commercial break, Danny Sullivan had to pit. Derek, it looked like nothing more than a potential tire going down.
That's right. They changed the two outside tires, filled them with fuel. The only good thing about it is he may take advantage of a yellow flag. If we get another yellow, he may be able to make up all that lost time because he's got a full fuel load. He can now stay out.
But he is fifth in points, and he is two laps down, so it has to happen a couple of times. We believe that all the leaders feel as though they can go the distance on the load of fuel they have now. The question becomes, do they feel, if they get another caution flag, can they improve their lot in life by stopping and changing tires? That would be the only hope that Sullivan would have if all the leaders, six guys in the lead lap, would come in to get new tires because they think they might be able to go faster.
Again, the man, the crowd are watching. The crowd are on their feet here watching their man, Jacques Villeneuve, because of Sullivan's pit stop. Villeneuve is now running in third place, and the crowd here just hope that he can catch the two Unsers.
Well, of course, this weekend is a very big weekend in the world of sports. There was soccer here in the Montreal area. There was an important tennis tournament, of course, in the country. And in the world of baseball, a very big story has been developing. As a matter of fact, all of 1985. Those of you who follow the sport probably know what I'm talking about. And it's a guy who wears a red and white uniform and plays most of the time in Ohio. And we are going to be going back to our studios in Bristol, Connecticut for a report on a situation that has happened and a record that has been broken in baseball. We're coming to you live from Saint-Pie, Quebec, and watching the Molson Indy 300. And we are turning to our studios in Bristol, Connecticut. There are less than 50 laps to go in this race. 180 laps complete here at Sonair. Hustle, Mr. Cincinnati Red. You suppose they'll put him in the Hall of Fame? Yeah, probably. 186 laps officially complete. Things are happening very rapidly, as you would expect in this racetrack. The two Unsers up front. Jacques Villeneuve runs in third position right now. Bobby Rahal, fourth. Johnny Rutherford, fifth. And Pancho Carter, again, being shown in sixth position. Cart scoring was showing him a lap down a few laps ago, but that did not seem at the time to be completely appropriate. And as it turns out, it wasn't. Pancho Carter turning in another sterling performance on an oval. Runs on the lead lap. He's the last car in the lead lap. One lap down, in order, Jeff Brabham, Ed Pym, two laps down, Danny Sullivan, the number two car of Tom Stiva, Jose Legarza. Those are your top 12 cars at this juncture of the race. Al Unser Sr. continues to lead this event. At age 46, this is his 22nd Indianapolis car season. The man who has led so many laps and won so many races in IndyCar competition is leading his son by 2.5 seconds, and Jacques Villeneuve, whose picture you will see right there, is running in third spot, just 1 second behind Junior and 3.5 seconds behind Al Unser Sr.
The crowd again were on their feet as he passed Jeff Brabham. He does all his passing into this last turn just in front of the grandstands, and all the crowd love everything he does. He has caught Al Unser Jr. He is right on Al Unser Jr.'s tail. It looks to me as if Junior is going to be in jeopardy. He's about to lose this second place because Villeneuve is very, very hot at the moment.
Just 35 laps to go. We saw Danny Sullivan setting the pace in this race until coming in for the pits. We theorized that he had a tire go down, but Jack, maybe you can amplify a little bit on that.
Larry, they pulled the car into the pits because Danny had radioed he thought he had a rear tire going down. They pulled the tire, made the exchange, checked it over. It was perfectly all right. So they sent it back up with the rubber on the backside, but they still don't know what the problem was, but it went away when they changed the tire.
Well, we have just been strafed by some tremendous firepower from above. I didn't even see the vehicle coming, but a jet has just gone over this racetrack and brought about a tremendous roar. Two jets and brought about a tremendous roar that even overpowered the race cars. And while all that was happening, Derek, Jacques made another move.
Jacques Villeneuve is now second. The jet overpowered the noise of the crowd, but they are on their feet, waving and shouting, doing all they can to urge their man on. Villeneuve is now second. He really, really has the bit between his teeth at the moment.
To go with the French as they speak it at home, as you said, Derek, Villeneuve, Jacques is turning in, I believe, his best race of this season. I know that he won in Elkhart Lake, but this is somewhat unexpected to do this well on an oval. Jacques turning in a great performance. Do you agree, Jack?
I not only agree, but I think I can give you a little insight. Number one, there's a lot of pressure on Jacques Villeneuve and the entire Canadian Tire team. Sponsorship is up for grabs for the car. They've been told that they have to perform in the last few races. Number two, Villeneuve, weak in oval track experience. Remember at the end of last year, he was shipped to tracks like Oswego, New York, and open-wheeled modifieds under the tutelage of Maynard Troyer and told, learn how to get around half-mile and 5/8-mile ovals. When you take a look at St. Air, it's very reminiscent of an Oswego Speedway that was maybe divvied up and laid down in thirds. That could be a major reason why he's doing so well here today.
Jack, he is coming on like a freight train. 197 laps of the 225 have been completed, and Villeneuve is visibly moving in on Alonso Sr., who is approaching slower traffic. And now he has caught him. The crowd is going to absolutely come apart as Jacques moves in.
Firestone is smoking ahead of him. This may bring out a yellow.
And losing water. Dennis Fires, you can see the precipitation. Villeneuve has moved under, and Al Unser has hit the wall. Al Unser Sr. got in Dennis Firestone's liquid and has hit the wall. The yellow flag has come out. A dramatic turn of events. Al Unser Sr., seemingly with this race in his hip pocket, is silent underneath the two marker for deceleration between turns one and two. Jacques Villeneuve has just taken the lead, is coming into the pits. What a turn of events. This gives the lead to Al Unser Jr. if he elects to stay out. Cars on the lead lap. Al Unser Jr., Johnny Rutherford, Pancho Carter, Bobby Rahal. If he can get out in time, Jacques Villeneuve. What will happen? Al Unser Sr. sits silently. Villeneuve is back out, apparently without losing a lap. Let's see exactly how this unfolds. My, what a turn of events.
Firestone began to lose the water coming off turn three. We could see it spray as he went down this front straight. He turned into turn one reasonably online. He could tell there was something wrong because he did slow down. Unser Sr. was the first man to hit that water. He spun, he hit the wall, he's out. Nothing to do with him, no driver mistake. Just the water from Dennis Firestone's car. An unfortunate situation for Al Unser Sr., having been so strong, not in the race, but the whole weekend since they came here.
And what this means for young Al Unser Jr. now, he sits right on the edge of becoming the new points leader. The three people in front of him, his dad, Mario Andretti, you might say his adopted cousin, I guess, and Emerson Fittipaldi, the former two-time world driving champion, are all out of this race. Al Unser Jr., maybe the new points leader when today is over.
This may be a good shootout from here to the end of the race because everybody else has stayed up except Villeneuve. Villeneuve did come in, topped up with fuel. He's now out behind Rahal. Kogan is between Rahal and Al Unser Jr. So this may be a heavy shootout between Unser Jr., Rahal, and Jacques Villeneuve for the last...
Well, Jack and Derek, what do we got here? 13 laps, no, that's 2:02 that's done, so we've got, let's call it 20 laps to go. Jack and Derek, here is your chance. Here are the guys on the lead lap. Al Unser Jr., the three car in the race, Bobby Rahal, of course, 76 of Jacques Villeneuve, the number 21 car of Johnny Rutherford, Pancho Carter in six, and Jeff Brabham is being shown as back on the lead lap. Who do you pick, Derek?
Okay, I'll take the man that's given me the excitement and the crowd the excitement, Jacques Villeneuve. He has enough adrenaline to pump himself up just a little bit more. I think he's going to take all the chances he needs to try and sneak by Rahal and Unser Jr. I'll pick Villeneuve.
You're taking Jacques. Jack, what's your pick?
I would have to go with Jacques Villeneuve myself because another story that's unfolding down here in the pits is, believe it or not, Al Unser Jr. has lost fifth gear. Now, on a road course, that'd be a big problem. But one of the things that you have a luxury of doing here when you're running on an oval is put the same gear ratio in third, fourth, and fifth gear. So all he's done when he comes up through the gearbox on the restarts is go into second, third, lay it into fourth, and forget about fifth that he blew up early in the race.
Well, Jack, you have just given me some inside information that I should not have been privy to, I guess, before I make my choice, because I was going to pick this guy, Al Unser Jr., but I admit that without top gear, that leaves a big question mark. However, in the interest of fairness, I'll pick Rahal. We haven't seen anything from Bobby Rahal. In the last 100 laps or so, he has not been lollygagging. He has been able to remain on the lead lap with the guys running up front. But Bobby Rahal, remember, he was the fastest qualifier. Jacques Villeneuve has to get around Bobby Rahal in order to go up and challenge Al Unser Jr. Kevin Kogan there in that blue and yellow Krenko car, of course, is also in the mix. But those of you at home have an opportunity to pick the man that you think will do well. Remember, Johnny Rutherford is another driver on the lead lap. We'll go over this one more time. Pancho Carter is in there driving the Valvoline Gallus Hawk number 6 in fifth position. And Jeff Brabham. Now, kart scoring says 56 seconds behind. That would be more than one lap, but they are showing him on the lead lap in sixth position. I think that Jeff is accurately running in sixth, but my guess is he is one lap down. Ed Pym remains out there in seventh position. Danny Sullivan in eighth, now one lap in arrears. Jose Lee Garza is ninth, two laps down. Tom Sneva is 10th, two laps down. The number 5 car of Al Unser Sr. was able to complete about 200 laps and will be credited with 11th position in today's race.
The one lap signal has just gone up. We have one more pace lap and then we're under green for the final shootout, and it should be good.
204 laps, 21 officially to go. Remember, this is only 8/10 of a mile around. So 20 laps on this racetrack equates to about the equivalent of maybe 8 or 9 on a big racetrack.
For such a tardy start with so many yellows, this race really has turned out to be one of the best of the season, with so many drivers at the head of the field.
Remember, the first two cars in line, Sullivan and Jeff Brabham, are not leading this race. That man is Al Unser Jr., looking for win number 3 of 1985. Green flag. He cannot get out of his own way. Al Unser Jr., with the loss of fifth gear, is passed by Rahal. Here is Jacques Villeneuve moving in. Jacques Villeneuve moves underneath Al Unser Jr. Rahal now has the lead in this race. It comes down to Rahal, and Al Unser Jr. cannot get back up to speed at all. Now begins to kick in. The traffic passes by on the inside. Nowhere for Al Unser Jr. to get back in line. Maybe that problem with fifth gear has shown up in other areas. There may be more than just a problem with the gearbox.
I don't think Jeff Brabham will want to lose a lap, so I can't see him moving over to let Bobby Rahal through. Rahal may have a problem here. Villeneuve is now closing up. Villeneuve is the danger man here.
What a break for Bobby Rahal. He was the sixth guy in the point standings. He thought that everybody would have to have bad luck for him to win the championship. All 5 of the competitors in front of Bobby Rahal in this year's season point standings have now dropped to the wayside. And Bobby Rahal stands an opportunity to win his second Indianapolis car race in a row. Jacques Villeneuve obviously running faster than Rahal, but it's so very hard to get around on this racetrack. Villeneuve and Rahal and Rahal and Jacques Villeneuve run into the wall. A tremendous crash going into the number 1 corner. Jacques Villeneuve and Bobby Rahal come together. Villeneuve is moving around. Bobby Rahal staring down Jacques Villeneuve, and Rahal letting his feelings be known. And now, what a turn of events. I said the last one was incredible. Now Johnny Rutherford is the man who sits right on the edge of winning his first surprise Indianapolis car win in 1985, and Bobby Rahal is unhappy.
Bobby is unhappy. Jacques will be unhappy. I think he had this race. This race was in his pocket. He just needed to calm down just a little bit. He was the last of the late breakers. Tried to get inside here. Rahal moved over as he should have. He had the line. He was the lead car. Jacques can't stop. Touches the back of Rahal's car here. Not only puts him out, but has nowhere to go himself except straight into the wall. They collect each other again here, and that's it. The day is over for the two. That's it.
A tremendously hard crash for Jacques Villeneuve into the fence. He going in first, taking Bobby Rahal in backwards. Now here's another angle on the shot. You see Villeneuve on the inside.
Rahal moves down to protect his position exactly as he should. Rahal has the line. Villeneuve tried to take it, brake too late, touch the back of Rahal. The game is over.
Well, perhaps some of the inexperience that Jacques has on the oval showing up. He really misjudged, apparently, the braking going into turn number 1. And just an absolutely astounding chain of events now has taken out our first, or 5 of our first 6 cars in the point standings for the 1985 season. Jack Arute is down in the pit area and it will be trying to update us on this situation. There you see the remains of Bobby Rahal's car on the left. The Bud number three and the Canadian Tire number 76 car on the outside, Jacques Villeneuve.
Just out of camera shot, we have another car that's in serious trouble over here exiting turn two. It's the number 71 car of Kiki Mansilla. He has made very, very hard contact with the wall. We couldn't see how it happened. We didn't see whether he got involved with another car, but it looked as if Mansilla was not able to get out of the car himself. He looks, he's in a little bit of trouble, but the best of medical help is there helping him at the moment.
Well, Dr. Steve Alvey and Steve Edward from the CART medical and safety teams are right there on hand and trying to extricate KK Mansilla from the number 71 car. Jack?
We're down here with Jacques Villeneuve trying to make his way back to his hauler. Jacques, first of all, are you all right?
Yeah, I'm all right. It's a hell of a bang, but I'm all right.
And then when you got out of the car, tell us exactly what happened going into the corner.
Well, Bobby seems to be staying on the outside going into one, and I stayed right behind him and waited till the last minute. And Bobby just jumped right in front of me when that happened, and I just stepped on the brake as hard as I could, and I couldn't stop and got into him.
Now, you were the first out of the car, and then one of the crew members, Steve Horn from the Budweiser crew, came up as you walked across the track and grabbed you. What did he say to you, Jacques?
Well, I'm sure he's mad at me. You know, it's my fault. I ran into Bobby, but it's a racing accident. The fault is completely mine, but... I thought I had the edge inside Bobby, and Bobby just closed the door on me, and I couldn't stop.
A tough break in the late stages. That gentleman looked like he was going to be the winner of the Molson Indy.
Without a doubt, Jacques Villeneuve, to use the American pronunciation, was the fastest car on the track. Still working on trying to extricate KK Mansilla. I think KK is out of the car, sitting on the wreckage there. He looks like he's sitting up, Derek. That's a pretty good sign that at least he's not going to be loaded on a stretcher, at least does not necessarily have to be loaded onto a stretcher, and they're still looking over KK.
That's right. When you hit any of these walls, anything above 70 or 80 miles an hour, it's such a huge bang that you almost get stung severely. I hope that Kiki has no serious injuries, but I can imagine that he will be dazed and stunned by having hit the wall, because coming through turn two, as we explained earlier on when we did the lap of the circuit, the cars go through there at 165 miles an hour. So even if he spun once, he's still going to make contact at well over 100 miles an hour.
We were just looking at Bobby Rahal and owner Jim Truman as they were headed back to the garage area. By the way, there were a lot of rumors this week about where drivers are going next year, and Rahal and the Truman team were sort of at the eye of the storm of those rumors, and Jim Truman told me that for next year, regardless of all other factors, question, have you Bobby Rahal signed? He said, of course we do, and we plan on IndyCar racing next year. So all those things that you are reading, kind of hold them in abeyance and use them as a factor. There is KK Mansilla collapsing as he heads for the stretcher, but he is at least conscious. KK going over to the ambulance, but getting back to the story that Jim Truman says that Bobby Rahal will be with him. Also, to update the situation with Doug Shearson and Al Unser Jr., they have both said that they will be together for next year, regardless of to go. 12 laps to go, and we are still working on cleaning up this racetrack, particularly in turn number one. They haven't even removed the cars yet. Derek, you know something? We are in jeopardy of finishing this race under yellow flag. Now, here are the point standings going into today's race. You can see that Al Unser Sr. was only 1 point behind Mario. They are out of the race. Emerson Fittipaldi, one of the first drivers out, was 3 points behind. Al Unser Jr. came into the race, 8 points in the rear. Sullivan, about 20. Al Unser Jr., we called him earlier out of the race. He's not out of the race. He's still out there, and he runs in second position now, believe it or not. Then the second 10 were Rahal, Villeneuve, Tom Sneva, Michael Andretti, and Rick Mears. This is an incredible break for Al Unser Jr. It is obvious he has no fifth, maybe no fourth gear. He cannot accelerate seemingly above 130 miles an hour. And they're running out under caution flag. And he was running in second. Perhaps he has slipped back to third. But he's still on the lead lap with the leader, Johnny Rutherford, who may win this race under caution flag.
We saw Kiki Mansilla being taken out by the doctors earlier on. Let me assure all Kiki's friends that he is in the best of medical help, because Dr. Steve Alvey and Dr. Terry Trammell from the Methodist Hospital are here, as they are at every kart race, and they are the best doctors in America for looking after these type of injuries that race car drivers sustain.
Not only that, Derek, but Methodist Hospital in Indianapolis has become really the mecca of sports medicine as far as automobile racing drivers go. When they are injured, they are always flown back to Methodist because they get experienced help and second, third, and even fourth aid because of their racing injuries. The doctors there, you mentioned Trammell and Alvey, know exactly what to do. The Methodist Hospital has airlift capabilities, either a plane or a helicopter, standing by at all races to take an injured driver, if necessary, back to Indianapolis and back to Methodist. The Horton medical team here at the racetrack can perform all of the first aid. Steve Edwards is an accomplished man when it comes to administering that here at the racetrack. They can stabilize a driver, put him on a piece of an aircraft, and then fly him to Methodist for the best help you can get.
It's hard for us to take a guess at what is wrong with Mansilla, but the doctors would not let him sit on the car and try and stand up as he did if they weren't pretty sure that he didn't have any broken bones. He did look very weak, but that can purely be because of the shock after sustaining such a sudden impact.
Okay, we're checking with CART scoring right now to find out exactly how many laps officially have been completed. I believe that we are up to 218. We're checking on that. Some of the information we have indicates that there are 8 laps to go, but well under 10. They have removed one of the cars that crashed in turn number 1. I think it was the Truman race car. The Budmobile is on the back of a record. There is the leader, Johnny Rutherford. Is that streaking toward victory? Well, we'll soon know. What a great moment that would be for Johnny and Betty Rutherford and Johnny Caples and his wife, Dana, who have worked so hard this year to try and put together a nice effort in IndyCar racing. He has been fast on ovals. A gremlin jumped up and bit him at Pocono when it looked like he was headed for victory. The number 76 Canadian tire car, the Labatt's White Auto Center machine, is still high above turn number 1. So yet another lap goes by, and we are at least 2 or 3 laps from getting that wreckage off of the speedway. There's Johnny Rutherford. Is that the eye of optimism?
If this race runs under green again, it certainly won't be for any more than 2 or 3 laps. So I would think Rutherford at the head of the pack is 5 cars ahead of Al Unser Jr. on the road. We know Unser Jr. hasn't got that fifth gear. So if we do get any green laps, Rutherford is in a very strong, comfortable position to take this race win away.
Now, here's an update on the rest of the cars still in the race. Jeff Brabham is now being listed as on the lead lap, but in third position. In fourth spot is Danny Sullivan, one lap down. Josele Garza is fifth. Now there's another change coming in, and it involves Pancho Carter. I do believe that Pancho, well, now they're saying Pancho is in second, so a couple of changes as we have now official word. There are 5 laps to go, and suddenly CART scoring is showing Pancho Carter in second spot. So this will be an old-fashioned sprint car race to the finish with Johnny Rutherford and Pancho Carter up front. Al Unser Jr. in third, 5 seconds back in about 5 or 6 cars. Jeff Brabham fourth, 1 lap down in fifth, Danny Sullivan. Josele Garza is in 6th, 2 laps down. Tom Sneva 7th, Ed Pym 8th, Kevin Kogan 9th, and the number 3 car of Bobby Rahal will be credited with 10th position. But we had not been overlooking Pancho, but timing and scoring was just not putting him up that high, and now they say that he is, and that does seem, Derek, right, because Pancho has not had a bad pit stop. He got a little bit out of step with everybody. He stopped one time under green, but I never did see him get lapped.
Well, I spoke about JR's comfort zone earlier on with Unser Jr. being so far back, but now Carter is right in the picture. And I can only think, if this does go green, now the workers down here in turn 1 are still putting a lot of this cement dust on the track to try and soak up all this moisture, this water and this oil that came out from the 2 cars that did crash. You see the workers here, they put the cement dust down, sweep it in, soak up the oil, and then they hope the cars can blow it away. I really don't see how they're going to get this cleaned up to run more than 2 or 3 laps at most to finish this race.
Well under 5 laps to go. Johnny Rutherford leads another one. AJ Foyt is the all-time leader in terms of wins for IndyCars. He's won 67 times. Mario Andretti is second with 45. Al Unser third at 37. Bobby Unser, before he retired, had won 35 times. And the late absolutely great Ralph De Palma. First half of the century, won 27 times. Roger Ward, 26. Here's a list of the people who have won so far this year. Mario, 3. Allenser Jr., twice. Sullivan, once. Villeneuve, once. Rick Mears, once. Fittipaldi, once. Ray Hall, once. But no Johnny Rutherford. This could be the next name on the list.
I think it will be. I think it will be. The workers are still down here on the track. There they are. Wally Dalamack will have told them to do the best job they can, make sure it's safe before they leave it.
Okay, here is confirmation. 222 laps will be completed this time around. 3 laps to go. We're still well under caution. Jack Arute can fill us in on KK Mancella's condition.
Mancella has been transferred to the Horton Safety Ambulance Emergency Room on wheels, if you will. And the word out of the door just moments ago, gentlemen, is that KK is awake and he's okay. And that's good news.
Yeah, it really is, Jack, because as you pointed out, Derek, there was significant damage to that race car. And, you know, 150, 160 miles an hour, if you hit cement it that fast, I don't think it makes much of a difference if it's 150 or 205. It's still cement and it don't give, does it?
That's right. And the most important aspect in an accident like that is to have such a superb medical team on hand that are there within seconds.
223 of 225 scheduled laps will be completed this time around. It looks like they are completing their work in turn number one. We may have an OK Corral shootout for the last two laps of this race. If so, they might, on the next lap, get green and white flag together, and then we would have one lap under green. 223 laps complete.
The first couple of laps through this turn one, there is so much cement dust down there on turn one at the moment. That is going to be very, very slippy. So JR and Pancho Carter are going to have to be extra careful down here at turn one. And JR, I'm sure, will try and anticipate the start, but Pancho Carter is no slouch when it comes to restarts when there's a race at stake.
Derek, I think the moment is happening right now. They are not going to get the green flag this time. The white flag is coming out. This race is over. I believe that this race is over because this time we complete lap 224. The white flag is being shown and Johnny Rutherford has won the race. Johnny Rutherford, Lone Star JR, is the winner for the first time in 1985 and the first time in a long time. Too long to even talk about, John and Betty. This is a great day down in Texas and a great day in Canada.
He didn't have to get it up for this final two or three laps. Pancho didn't have to make the challenge. It's all over because of the little incident with Jacques Villeneuve and Bobby Rahal down at turn one.
I can just hear Pancho muttering and murmuring underneath his breath right now and rubbing those hands together. He's going to give it a shot. He'll move to the outside of Johnny Rutherford. Now, wait a minute. What happens this time?
Carter was across the line first. Pancho Carter may have won this race.
We may have been premature. That race may have just gone to Pancho Carter. Let's wait for an official word. What happens in that case? Does the race officially begin when the leader crosses the line or when the green flag comes out? Has Pancho Carter won?
I never saw a green flag. I never saw a green flag. I don't know whether the race ever got into a green situation again.
What an interesting question, because there was no green, it was checker. I don't know that the final chapter has yet to be written. Anything from kart timing and scoring, are they saying?
I'm sure Johnny Caples and Rick Gallus will be down there consulting the little rule book to see who's right on this. But Pancho Carter did
cross
take
the line
the first.
First.
He did take the checkered flag.
Absolutely astounding. Absolutely. We do not know, as of this moment, officially, who the winner of this race is. Johnny Rutherford looking around, looking toward victory lane. Pancho Carter looking toward victory lane. Kart officials are pushing Pancho or pointing the direction for Pancho to go to victory lane. And now we have two guys trying to get into one parking space. That has happened to me so many times.
Well, Carter
Johnny
seems to
Rutherford
say he did it.
Is now being told from kart scoring that he is the winner. Well, and now the handshake's coming out. And Johnny Rutherford, the crew beginning to jump around, is apparently going to celebrate those spoils of victories that Bill Elliott did a week ago. It may not be worth as much money, but it has to be just as bright a moment for Johnny Rutherford.
Maybe we need a 5-lap trophy dash.
Now it's just been changed again. Now we stand corrected. We'll try and stay with this because The official word off of the CART radio has just been changed. We have had two official words from CART, Johnny Rutherford and Pancho Carter. Well, this will be a very interesting 2 minutes. You'll wait it out with us. We still do not know who won the Molson Indy. Was declared the winner of this year's International Race of Champions. The same set of circumstances has befallen Johnny Rutherford. Passed by Pancho Carter as the checkered, not green, the checkered flag, but that is normally a racing flag, came out as we rounded turn number three on the final lap of this race. Johnny was leading. Pancho accelerated hard on the high side. He crossed the finish line before Johnny Rutherford did. But the question was, does this race begin when the checkered flag comes out, or should they have finished this race under yellow flag conditions?
Here's a replay. You see, Carter did anticipate that something was going to happen. He went to the high side. I don't think Johnny Rutherford was even in the right gear, because Carter actually pulls easily away here. He's the first man to take the checkered flag. I think he is the winner.
Well, there have been a couple of official announcements from CART, and the most recent one was that the number six car of Pancho Carter is the winner of this race. Still double-checking all the timing and scoring charts, probably consulting the rule books, but Johnny Rutherford is standing by silently as they push the number six Gallus Racing Valvoline Hawk race car a little more closer to victory lane. Nay, it is in victory lane, and apparently the decision is firm. Pancho Carter has won for the second time in his career an Indianapolis car race. There you see a panorama of the front stretch here at the Saint-Pierre Super Speedway in Saint-Pierre, Quebec. And that tower there on the left, that's where Derek and I are positioned right now as we watch with you in, I got to say, utter amazement. And Derek, I am not familiar enough with those fine printed paragraphs in the rule book to know what is the official call in a situation like this. When you come off of turn number four under yellow flag, when the checkered flag waves, is that an indication that this race is ending, or is it restarting? And if it is indeed restarting, do you start racing in turn number three or not until the leader crosses the line?
Well, that's probably the same question Rutherford asks himself now. But we have Jack Arut down there who may enlighten us on the situation. He is with JR. Down to you, Jack.
Well, Johnny Rutherford collared me and said, hey, I'm the winner of this race. Talk to me. This is my victory lane. Johnny, that's the way you see it right now.
Well, yes, it is. When we came down here, it was a checkered flag. There was no green to come out. There was one more lap with a white flag. The yellow was still out. We had no idea we were going to go. The track wasn't in shape to run for the charge. This was stupid to come down here like this.
Now, the question, we talked to Kirk Russell to ascertain who was the winner. He said that it is Pancho Carter. Now, what is your recourse now after the fact? What can you do?
I honestly don't know. We came off of the corner there. I thought it was just going to be a routine checkered under the yellow, and they had the green flag. They had the checkered out, and it was, you know, I figured it was over.
Well, like Yogi Berra says, gentlemen, it isn't over till it's over, and you can be sure Johnny Rutherford and the Vermont American team are going to have their say before this day's out.
Well, it's a victory lane without a winner, at least at this point, unless you're Pancho Carter. He has been declared the winner of the Molson Indy 300. This race has been brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Pennzoil Motor Oil, quality protection. Ask for it. And by STP Corporation. On the world's racetracks, on the world's roads, depend on STP, your car care company. We'll be back with some closing thoughts here from the Sonair Super Speedway after these messages. With the declared winner of this race, Pancho Carter.
Pancho, congratulations. A victory by any words is still a victory, right?
Well, I don't know by any words, but it was a hard-earned victory.
Your strategy there when the yellow was still out with the white flag displayed?
Well, the white flag was displayed and Nick Fenora held up one finger, which means we were going one more lap. And I figured, well, it's a possibility we're going to finish under the yellow. And then the pace car dropped off in the backstretch, which is a signal for a restart. So I figured we were going for a restart, so I jumped up on the outside groove. And when the green light came on, I accelerated past Johnny and beat him to the start-finish line. So I was first to the checkers.
Your feelings on your first victory of 1985?
I'm excited about my first victory, 85. It's only the second IndyCar one, so this is, you know, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of controversy and they'll check it over in the rule book. But right now, I'll take it.
Gentlemen, I'm listening to Johnny Rutherford on one side and Pancho Carter on the other. I think I'm at Saturday Night Wrestling.
We're on a white flag.
Well, Jack, for the time being, Pancho Carter is declared the winner of this race. The winner's circle interview, by the way, has been brought to you by Goodyear, makers of the high-performance radio, The Eagle. By the way, Keke Mancella has been reported as having a slight concussion. The new points leader is Al Unser Jr. after today's race. He is credited with third position. He gets a total of 15 points, I believe it is. That moves his total up to 115, or rather 16 points, moving his total up to well above 110 for the season. Pancho Carter, the man right there that the card officials have said is the rule book. Johnny Rutherford will be credited with second, and Al Unser Jr. third. Derek, what do you think?
An amazing day, an amazing race, an amazing finish. I'm just glad that it wasn't two championship contenders that found themselves in that position, because it would be unfair if controversy like this went right down to the end.
Well, stay with ESPN for lots of exciting racing action to come in 1985. We're not done yet.